Millions of students return to schools across the Philippines, with some enduring classroom congestion and flooding.
Police file alarm and scandal complaint against the motorist involved in a road rage incident.
The Philippine Tax Bureau surpasses its collection target for July 2023.
And Gilas Pilipinas gears up for a do-or-die game against Italy in the FIBA World Cup.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Inside.
You're watching Top Story. Millions of public school students across the Philippines return to classrooms as the government tests a new K-10 curriculum. The Education Department says more than 22 million students were officially enrolled for the new school year. Dozens of schools in six regions will join the pilot implementation of the revised K-10 program called the Matatag Curriculum. Under the revamped K-10, learning areas have been reduced to 5 from 7, covering language, reading and literacy, mathematics, as well as subjects promoting patriotism and good manners.
Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte supervised the opening of classes in Cebu Province. There, she led the turnover of new classrooms. In a speech, Duterte admitted there are still issues to be addressed in the education sector, especially the shortage of teachers and the curriculum. Some schools in northern Luzon suspended their first day of classes following the onslaught of Typhoon Goring. The Education Department assured the public help is on the way.
Sa ngayon, ang tinututukan po natin, number one, kasi nga po meron din talaga tayong mga naantala sa pagpasok dahil dito sa bagyong si Goring. Meron po tayong mga areas na flooded. Region 4A, for example, Region 4B. Yung sa Cagayan, meron tayong mga schools na nagsuspend din ng klase kahit na first day dahil nga sa pagbabaha. So yan po, tinitingnan natin, no, kung kailangan natin magbaba ng pondo para sa cleanup eh gusto natin gawin sa lalong madaling panahon.
Classes pushed through even in flooded schools in Kalumpit, Bulacan. Schools were forced to adjust their hours to accommodate the students. Some are implementing a 4-shift school day, with the earliest at 6 in the morning and the last shift starts at 5 p.m. 700 students are forced to pack into 8 classrooms in one town because 25 other classrooms are still flooded.
Here in Metro Manila, classroom congestion remained a top concern. The Batasan Hills National High School in Quezon City had to divide 90 classrooms into two to accommodate over 18,000 students. Classes are also held in shifts, with some still conducted through modular or online setup. Meanwhile, in the hotly contested schools in the Embo villages transferred to Taguig, the opening of classes went smoothly. 5,000 students are enrolled in the schools in those areas, and officials expect it to go higher.
A Philippine teachers group expressing disappointment over the seeming lack of preparation for the opening of classes. Vladimir Katua, chair of the Alliance of Concerned Teachers, says little adjustments were made to accommodate the increasing number of students. He shares they have forwarded concerns of inadequate classrooms, school supplies, and manpower to the Education Department. But they were left unanswered. Ketua believes the Education Department lacks the political will to properly address the needs of the sector.
May sulat tayo July 13, 2022 pa lamang, no? Ibig sabihin, a month before the August of opening of 2022 and 23. Unfortunately, hindi ito nagawa ng paraan. In fact, ay sumulat din tayo, Carmina, August 8 para sana sa pagbubukas ng klase for August 29. Unfortunately, ay those problems, those mga sulat ay hindi pa rin nagagawa. Dapat mayroong political will, dapat na budgetan ito, no, ng mas mataas o madagdagan sana. Like for example, yung pagdaragdag sana ng guro, no? Imagine sa COA report, makikita naman natin yan sa bilang public documents, no? Kakaunti lamang yung na-hire, yung feeding program, yung mga learning materials, ang daming mga ano eh, mga budget na dapat sana ay magastos o gastusin. Hindi pa ito pinagpursigahan ng ating DepEd Secretary, no? Makikita naman yan sa COA report.
The Philippine National Police employed over 32,000 policemen for the first day of classes. Police Chief Benjamin Acorda Jr. says the PNP also opened assistance desks outside schools. He added they're planning to make these a permanent fixture to ensure peace and security in schools.
So far, as of now, wala man naman tayong mga major concerns na natatanggap. Normally, ang mga namomonitor natin ng mga problema when it comes to opening of classes, yun yung mga snatching, mga kwan ng kabataan. So, yun ang mga tinitingnan natin.
Now, as public schools open classes today, the United Nations Children's Fund, or UNICEF, is pushing for the learning recovery of the Filipino youth, especially those affected by the pandemic. UNICEF says the future of millions of Filipino children hang in the balance. As it notes, the learning crisis is a major driver of intergenerational poverty and inequality. A 2019 survey found around 78% of Filipinos aged 3 and 4 were not attending daycare, while 28% of 5-year-olds were not enrolled in kindergarten. A positive note, according to UNICEF, is the launch of the new K-10 curriculum focused on foundational skills, as well as getting millions of learners back into schools after the COVID pandemic.
Preparing packed meals for students can sometimes be a daunting task. Willard Chang tells us how to make sure kids are eating safe and nutritious food.
Planning is key to ensuring food safety when preparing packed meals for students going to school. According to Ana Baez, Science Research Specialist of the Food and Nutrition Research Institute of the DOST.
Plano mo yung mga ingredients, plano mo yung time, and of course, syempre yung budget. Iswak mo na rin din syempre sa bibili mo ingredients.
Proper cooking of food is a must, while meals should be consumed within 3 to 4 hours after they were prepared.
Mas mabilis po masira ang pagkain pagka mas maraming moisture at wala po acid. Kaya nga po pag nagbabangon tayo kahit sa mga travel natin, di ba? Adobo yung madalas kasi may suka po siya kasi magtatibid siya. So wag po tayo magpabangon ng mas maraming sabaw kasi mas na-attract po dito yung mga bacteria.
To ensure proper nutrition, stay away from foods that are too salty and sweet. Be sure to include drinking water.
Una kong laging sinasabi is planning. Kasi kung magagawa ka ng sandwich, compare mo dun sa biscuits na gawa na, it will take time, di ba sir? So sana si mommy estimated din niya yung time niya. Mas maganda po kasi kung mag-prepare siya ng mga sandwiches na manilesen niya yung fats, di ba? Tapos kung gagawa siya ng chicken sandwich, kunyari, mas pipiliin niya yung chicken breast, tatanggalin niya yung mga fatty parts dun sa chicken.
Baez adds, bringing packed meals to schools can be cheaper and healthier. If purchasing food outside, one has to make sure that the food's packaging is clean and safe.
So the mother also should orient, give ideas sa children bago siya umalis ng bahay. Huwag kang bumili ng ano, pag-isipan mo kung ano yung bibili mo. Diba? Ang bibili ka ba ng isang sandwich or bibili ka ba ng chicheria na chips na 10 pesos din? Diba? So, tignan mo. Kasi kung pareho lang naman din sila ng price, so yun nga sinasabi natin, piliin mo na yung mas good ang quality.
The FNRI's Pinggang Pinoy can serve as a visual guide to help Filipinos adopt healthy eating habits and attain the proper nutrition. Willard Cheng, ABS-CBN News.
In other news, the Philippine poll body tightened security measures following the influx of aspiring candidates for the upcoming village and youth council elections. COMELEC spokesperson John Rex Laudianco says they deployed more personnel in venues where BETs can file their certificate of candidacy. The COMELEC also investigating 4 possible cases of election-related violence. This includes Monday's incident in Libon Albay, where a re-electionist village head was shot dead.
Apat na insidente po ang tinitignan namin. 2 po sa Libon Albay, isa po sa Maguindanao at isa sa Rizal. So lahat po ito ay ina-analyze na po ng ating pinagsamang PNP, AFP at COMELEC. At pag nag-recommend po ang PNP at AFP na ilagay sa areas of concern, gagawin po natin ito at susundin natin ito. At kung sakasakaling kinakailangan po iakyat ng COMELEC sa COMELEC control ng mga lugar na yan, mapanatili lang po ang kapayapaan, hindi po kami mag-atubiling gawin po yan.
The Quezon City Police District files an alarm and scandal complaint against a dismissed policeman in a viral road rage incident. Four police officers will serve as complainants. Wilfredo Gonzalez was caught on video pulling out a gun and brandishing it in front of a cyclist during an altercation earlier this month. Gonzalez earlier claimed he reached a settlement with that cyclist, but authorities say it won't stop them from filing charges against him.
Hindi naman covered ang alarm scandal ng amicable settlement. Kung sila ay nagka-amicable settlement man, eh nasa kanilang dalawa yon sa mga krimen na maaring nag-transpire in between them. Pwede sana nating i-file nito ng, well, attempted homicide na sinasabi ni Atty. Futon. Pwede yun. Grave threats. Sigurado yon. Kung lumabas yung lista, kailangan na kasi doon ang personal na complaint.
As for Interior Secretary Benner Abalos, he says a settlement reached between Gonzalez and the cyclist sends a wrong message to the public.
Hindi natin pwedeng pabayaan ito ng ganyan. Otherwise, ano ito, aregluhan na lang mangyayari dito? Ganito na lang ba? At the very least, sinatawag na alarms and scandal, tatlong elemento lang ipuprove mo yan. Number one, it causes disturbance or scandal. Nakita naman natin. Buong bansa in skandalo dito. Number two, it was committed in a public place. Sabihin mo, nag-areglo na, tapos na. Anong tapos na? Yung tao, hindi ko alam kung tinakot mo o hindi. Kung maano pa man yun, mananagot ka pa rin.
The Land Transportation Office has suspended the driver's license of Gonzalez for 90 days as they investigate the incident. Gonzalez was dismissed from service for his involvement in the escape of drug suspects and was also involved in a similar gun-toting incident a few years ago. Philippine National Police Chief Benjamin Acorda Jr. appealing to the cyclist involved in that road rage incident to come forward. Acorda says they need the cyclist's help to mount a strong case against Gonzalez. The police also calling on other witnesses to give their statements.
We need for the cyclist, really, huwag matakot, don't be intimidated, come out in the open and kasama natin sa pag-build up ng case is his statement. So, mas maganda kung lumabas siya and hinihikayat ko na lumabas siya at magsalita.
The Office of the Ombudsman defends its decision not to hold former President Rodrigo Duterte and his economic advisor Michael Yang liable for an overpriced deal on COVID-19 test kits. This after former Senator Richard Gordon, who led the Senate probe on the Pharmaly scandal, claimed Duterte appointed the involved former budget officials in the anomalous deal while Yang financed the company.
Ang sinasabi ko, dapat managot ang presidente.
Hanggang malaki.
Diyan siya lahat ang nag-appoint eh. Pag tinignan niyo yung report ko, lahat naman na una akong pinalalampas eh. Nakikita mo, lumalaki ang sunog pagka lumalapit sa presidente. Eh talagang plunder talaga yan. Nakawan nila talaga ang bayan, di ba? Plunder yan eh. Ba't ka mo? Nag-accumulate sila ng kon eh. Ng pera at saka mga coaching magaganda. Saan nila kinuha yan?
But the ombudsman insists there is no evidence to support Gordon's claims.
There is no evidence on record also that the financing was Michael Yang. Pinapakinggan namin, may mga na-save kami mga video ng hearing ng CNA. Parang wala man ang kapanggit sa mga witnesses na involved si Presidente Duterte.
The Philippines and Australia aiming to hold more joint military exercises following the conclusion of the Indo-Pacific Endeavor 2023, also known as Exercise Alon. AFP Chief General Romeo Bronner thanked Australia's continued support to the country as he welcomed General Angus Campbell, Chief of the Australian Defence Force, in a courtesy call on Tuesday. For General Campbell, the military drills highlight the importance of cooperation among allies to achieve mutual benefit and partnership.
The Philippine Local Water Utilities Administration sounding the alarm over the high rate of water leakage in the country. Its chairman, Ronnie Ong, says 523 water districts serving areas outside Metro Manila yield an average non-revenue water rate of 29.34%. That's significantly higher than the 20% global average. This also means an annual water loss of around 488 million cubic meters, exceeding half of Angat Dam's capacity. Ong now calling for government support to address the water crisis in the country.
Out of the 532, I think around 50 to 70% of them are still owned, the government run. They call it government owned.
Oh.
So water districts na kailangan po talaga nila ng tulong at pondo. We have the water, we're throwing it away. We have to fix that at the hoping for the support of both Congress and Senate to fund yung NRW project na around 5 billion a year.
Philippine agriculture officials are confident rice prices will remain stable despite recent typhoons. Jervis Manahan reports.
The Department of Agriculture is expecting minimal agricultural damage from Super Typhoon Gorin, which battered several provinces in northern Luzon. While reports are yet to come in, DA Field Operations Service Director Unicols Manalo said Gorin had a similar track from Egay. Egay affected farmers to recover from their losses, so the latest typhoon is not expected to leave a significant amount of additional damage.
Yun po kasing ibang mga areas na tinamaan din ni Egay, same lang din itong tinahak na pat ni Gorin, hindi na rin po talaga sila magtanim. No? Dahil ang pinaghahandaan ng ating mga kababayang magsasaka ay yung dadating na dry season, which is officially, it will start this coming September 16.
Manalo acknowledged that typhoons Egay and Falcon as well as Habagat left a big damage in rice and corn plantations. The agency didn't comment on whether the damages will affect rice prices, which is soaring in the market. However, Manalo expressed confidence about the price stability of rice as we enter the harvest season.
Talagang harvest season naman ngayon. Sinasabi nga natin na kung maraming supply is bababa sa market. But kailangan kasi natin rin i-consider yung cost ng inputs dun sa mga areas, no, na pinanggagalingan ng supply ng bigas.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. wants the government to find ways to control rice prices. The president says relevant government agencies should utilize all available legal tools to bring down the price of the staple. In a sectoral meeting recently held in Malacanang, Marcos voiced concern over the spike in rice prices, which has been attributed to hoarding, the effects of storms, and the added costs posed by middlemen. The president, who is also concurrent agriculture chief, called on the Bureau of Customs to work with the Agriculture Department to study the possibility of donating confiscated rice to the Social Welfare Agency.
In related news, the Bureau of Customs says a 20% commission awaits tipsters on smuggled or hoarded goods. Customs Commissioner Bienvenido Rubio said there is an existing reward system under the Customs Modernization and Tariff Act. The reward is equivalent to 20% of the value of the goods reported as smuggled or hoarded. But the informant will not be entitled to the cash reward if the confiscated goods were donated or declared for official use by the government. The Philippine government has marked over 1,000 spots across the country to highlight significant moments in Philippine history. But as Jose Carretero tells us, some of these historical markers are in a sorry state. Take a look.
Nearly every day, Erica and Abby pass by this statue and marker at Ongpin Street in Binondo, Manila. But both admit they don't even know who or what it stands for.
Rebulto lang po, alam namin.
Sign po ng nasa Chinese town, ganun.
Ongpin Street was named after Don Ramon Ongpin, whose statue stands right at the center of Manila's Chinatown. He was a Filipino-Chinese businessman who aided the Katipuneros during the 1898 revolution. The National Historical Commission of the Philippines placed a marker beside the statue, one of the more than 1,500 all over the country, to explain the significance of the statue's shrines or heritage sites to Philippine history. But the NHCP admits not only are the markers ignored, many have been neglected.
Hindi natin may tatanggi. Maraming mga panandang pakasaysayan na maaring dahil hindi na napahalaga ng community, maaring nalimot na sa kasamang palad, napapabayaan, nadudumihan, nangangalawang.
One that seems to have been forgotten is the birthplace of General Antonio Luna in Barangay 282 in Manila. The house is in disrepair, the flags faded and worn. There's even a shanty right beside the marker. Caretaker and Barangay Kagawad Elpidio Donato says no one from the government comes to check on the site.
Mga taga-government, wala na. Maliban lang pag-birthday niya, nung araw pa na ni Mayor Lim at ni Mayor Atienza. Yeah, wala na.
This was the site of the historic cry of Pugadlawin, which signaled the start of the revolution against Spain. The Quezon City government has someone standing guard over the brass statues ever since some parts of the statues were stolen.
Sinisira nila, ninanakaw yung revolto, sinisira mga halaman. Sana wag.
It's a different story for the markers and statues of the popular heroes which have become tourist sites, like this shrine of Andres Bonifacio in Manila.
Maganda siya kasi it reminds us ng history, especially dito sa Maynila.
Para po maalala yung mga ginawa ng mga bayaning Pilipino para sa kalayaan, kapayapaan at sakripisyo po.
Historian Xiao Chua says we need to realize the importance and value of these historical markers.
Tandaan natin na yung mga marker na yan, hindi lang yan bakal, hindi lang yan mga letra, May dahilan kung bakit yan nilagay dyan. Ibig sabihin, yung taong pinanganak dyan o yung pangyayaring nangyari dyan ay may kahalagahan sa ating kasaysayan at isa sa mga bumuo ng ating lipunan.
The NHCP says they are unable to monitor the condition of the markers once these have been turned over to the local government units or LGUs.
Kung mayroon po kayong mga nakikitang problema, magbigay nyo lang alam po sa NHCP. But we also encourage local communities, local government units, no, na magkaroon ng inisyatiba na pangalagaan itong mga markers, as simple as painting them pag nangangalawang na.
The NHCP can only appeal to the public to treat these markers with respect since they are important symbols of our history and identity as Filipinos. Jose Carretero, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines and the United Kingdom agreed to further boost bilateral ties in the wake of international issues of mutual concern. ABS-CBN correspondent Katrina Domingo joins us on the line for the details of that. Kat? Kat, you there? Okay, we'll try to get Kat later on in the program. Up next, former U.S. President Donald Trump set to go on trial in the middle of the fight for the Republican presidential nomination.
And Philippine shares return to positive territory to start the trading week. More news when we return.
Still watching Top Story, here again are the headlines. Millions of students return to schools across the Philippines, with some enduring classroom congestion and flooding.
Police file alarm and scandal complaint against the motorist involved in a road rage incident.
The Philippine Tax Bureau surpasses its collection target for July 2023.
And Gilas Pilipinas gears up for a do-or-die game against Italy in the FIBA World Cup.
On the line, our correspondent Katrina Domingo to tell us about the visit of UK Foreign Secretary James Cleverly. Kat?
Hi,
Iran, the Philippines, and the United Kingdom have agreed to develop a framework that would define the scope of its bilateral ties with the foreign secretaries of both countries, underscoring the need for closer cooperation amid pressing and evolving regional and international issues of mutual concern. The joint statement of intent to develop a framework agreement was signed during the visit of UK Foreign Secretary James Cleverly here in Manila, and it is designed to build on exchanges of the two countries that have been undertaking in the areas of defense, security, maritime, climate, economy, as well as people-to-people ties. Now, Philippine Foreign Affairs Secretary Enrique Manalo says it also signals the strengthening of the bilateral ties between Manila and London in the sectors of trade, investment, security, and maritime cooperation, among other fields. The two foreign secretaries made no mention of China and the tensions in the West Philippine Sea, but underscored that the Philippines and the UK's relationship are founded on the shared values that respect openness, freedom, and respect the rule of law and the adherence to that rule of law. Cleverly also noted that the UK is building enduring partnerships in the Philippines, is one of those key partners, and he says the UK is looking forward to sharing knowledge on maritime law, promoting maritime domain awareness, as well as enhancing maritime protections along with the Philippines. Cleverly actually visited the Philippine Coast Guard earlier to hear about the work they do to uphold the UNCLOS and protect the maritime environment in Philippine waters. Cleverly also had a meeting with Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., and he noted that this is a good time this is an exciting time for both the Philippines and the United Kingdom, as the bilateral trade between the two countries is at its highest level in its history, which now stands at 2.4 billion euros annually in terms of goods and services. Ron?
Thanks for the update, Katrina Domingo.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with PAGASA forecaster Altsar Aurelio. Altsar?
Yes, good afternoon, Denise, Ron, and also to all televiewers. As of 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Typhoon Goring was spotted at the 165 kilometers east of Calayan, Cagayan. It slightly intensified. Now, the maximum sustained winds of Typhoon Goring is 165 kilometers per hour and gustiness of up to 205 kilometers per hour. It expected to move west-northwestward at 18 kilometers per hour. Based on our forecast track, the center or the eye of the Goring expected to move towards the Taiwan Batanes area before exit the Philippine area of responsibility. The Goring exit the Philippine area of responsibility is tomorrow evening or Thursday morning. Because of the Typhoon Goring, Tropical Cyclone Warning Signal number 4 is hosted over northeastern portion of Babuyan Islands. Signal number 3 over southern portion of Batanes and the rest of Babuyan Islands. Signal number 2 over northeastern portion of mainland Cagayan, rest of Batanes, northern portion of Ilocos Norte, and northern portion of Apayao. Signal number 1 has been raised over northern and eastern portion of Isabela, rest of Ilocos Norte, rest of Cagayan, rest of Apayao, northern portion of Abra, and northern portion of Kalinga. Because of the effect pertaining heavy rainfall due to Typhoon Goring, today we expect intense to torrential rains over Babuyan Islands, while heavy to intense rains over Batanes, Ilocos Norte, northern portion of Abra, Apayao, and northern and eastern portion of mainland Cagayan. Meanwhile, the severe tropical storm Haikwe outside the Philippine area of responsibility. As of 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the center of this severe tropical storm is at was at 1,645 kilometers east of extreme northern Luzon. This severe tropical storm has maximum sustained winds of 95 kilometers per hour and gustiness of up to 115 kilometers per hour. It is expected to enter the Philippine area of responsibility tomorrow morning and will be named Hana. As of this moment, there's no direct effect of this weather disturbance. Southwest monsoon, enhanced by typhoon Goring, is affecting affecting most part of the country, especially in Metro Manila. In Metro Manila, for the next 24 hours, we expect cloudy sky with scattered rain showers and thunderstorm. Also, we expect gusty winds due to southwest monsoon. That is our weather update for two tropical cyclone from Pag-asa. I'm Altsar D. Aurelio.
Thanks, Altsar. Now overseas, tropical storm Idalia lashes western Cuba as it crawls its way to Florida's Gulf Coast. Cubans rushed to evacuate coastal towns and secure their homes as Idalia made landfall Monday afternoon, packing maximum sustained winds of 112 kilometers per hour. The storm is expected to further strengthen over the hot waters of the Gulf of Mexico before slamming into Florida as a Category 3 hurricane later this week. U.S. President Joe Biden has approved an emergency declaration for the state and assured Florida Governor Ron DeSantis of his full support.
Another wave of excessive heat has descended upon Phoenix, Arizona. Temperatures there rose to as high as 46.6 degrees Celsius or 116 degrees Fahrenheit. The new heat alert comes after weeks of respite from a searing month of July when temperatures stayed above 40 degrees Celsius for 31 days straight.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump is set to stand trial in the thick of the Republican presidential fight. The federal court in Washington, D.C. scheduled his trial on March 4th on charges linked to his attempts to overturn his election defeat. More in this report.
Lawyers for former President Donald Trump were back in Washington Monday for a hearing that set a March 4, 2024 date for his trial in conjunction with his alleged effort to stop the peaceful transfer of power at the U.S. Capitol on January 6, 2020. Trump's lawyers had no comment for VOA, but expressed their disappointment to the judge. They had asked to put off the trial until April 2026, after the November 2024 presidential elections. The prosecution wanted the proceeding to start January 2nd, with jury selection in December. One expert told VOA he believes U.S. District Judge Tanya Chutkan is a strong judge who made a wise decision.
She made some very good points that the public really needs to know. They need to know one way or the other before this election, you know, whether Trump is guilty of these very serious charges.
A grand jury of citizens in Washington voted to indict Trump on four felony counts in the case, including conspiracy to defraud the United States and conspiracy to obstruct an official proceeding. He has pleaded not guilty to the charges and has repeatedly claimed, without evidence, that the charges are politically motivated.
How can my corrupt political opponent, crooked Joe Biden, put me on trial during an election campaign that I'm winning by a lot, but forcing me nevertheless to spend time and money away from the campaign trail in order to fight bogus, made-up accusations and charges?
Trump has said the indictments are only boosting his support among voters. But one of his Republican opponents, former Arkansas Governor Asa Hutchinson, disagrees, saying there is no way Trump can win a general election.
Republican voters have to understand we can't win with Donald Trump, and that's why I addressed it very directly.
Many of the January 6 events happened out in the open for everyone to see. Presidential historian Alan Lichtman says leaving Trump vulnerable to a possible conviction ahead of the November 2024 presidential elections.
What if Trump is sitting in jail, which is not impossible either? Technically, he could still run, but would the Republicans really want, at the top of their ticket, a guy who's been convicted of subverting our democracy?
Trump is the first former American president to face criminal charges. If convicted, he could spend the rest of his life behind bars. He is also facing charges in New York, Georgia, and Florida. Cindy Sain, VOA News.
Toyota halts its operations at a dozen factories in Japan due to a system failure Tuesday. Local media said it's not immediately clear when the system will be restored. All local plants, except for the Miata plant in Fukuoka and the Kyoto plant, are affected. Operations at the world's largest automaker also ground to a halt last year when one of its suppliers was hit by a cyber attack.
Population growth in some Asian nations seem to be a major driver of economic expansion. A report from Moody's Investor Service says population growth in South and Southeast Asia will significantly boost regional labor inputs and consumption. The Philippines is one of six developing Asian countries that is expected to account for one-third of the global population increase over the next two decades. Moody's says improved infrastructure development and government effectiveness has allowed the Philippines to facilitate stronger growth compared to peers such as Bangladesh and Pakistan. This, as it notes, population growth alone is not enough to achieve inclusive growth. Moody's says better education and quality infrastructure are also key to boosting economic expansion.
Meanwhile, the research arm of the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, or APEC, sees growth in the region slowing down. It cites trade restrictions coupled with inflation and lingering effects of the El Niño. APEC study says the region's growth in the first quarter was at 3.9%, down from 5.8% in the same period last year. Data from the World Trade Organization shows the number of trade restrictive measures being enforced in APEC has reached 480 as of May. The implementing rules and regulations of the Philippines' first national investment fund set to take effect on September 12. Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno told reporters the Maharlika Fund's IRR was published in the Official Gazette on Monday. The rules take effect 15 days after publication. Diokno also says a search has begun for the president and CEO of the corporation that will manage the fund. President Marcos signed a controversial bill that created the MIF in July, despite strong opposition.
The Philippines' booming e-commerce sector expected to continue growing. The U.S. Department of Agriculture estimates total e-commerce sales in the Philippines to reach $24 billion by 2025, with food and beverage accounting for a fifth of that total. The country's overall e-commerce sales are expected to grow at a compound annual growth rate of 9%. The report added half of the more than 70 million online users in the country participate in cross-border e-commerce. From just $1 million in 2022, purchases of food and beverage products through CBE could quadruple to $5 million in 2025. Among the top purchase products of Filipinos last year were food supplements, baked goods, chocolates, and pet food.
Philippine debt payments almost double in the first half of the year. Data from the Treasury Bureau showed the Marcos administration paid 907.9 billion pesos of its obligations from January to June. That's 98% higher compared to the same period last year. A bulk of the debt service went to amortization or the settlement of the principal amount at 625.4 billion. Meanwhile, interest payments rose by 10% to 282.4 billion pesos. Aside from payment to local lenders, the Philippine government also settled 89.57 billion pesos in interest owed to foreign financiers in the first half.
And speaking of borrowing, the Philippines secures a fresh 30 billion yen loan from Japan aimed at helping disaster-hit areas recover faster from calamities. Signing the deal in Tokyo for the loan, which amounts to 11.6 million pesos, were Philippine Budget Secretary Benjamin Diokdo and Japan International Cooperation Agency's Senior Vice President Nakazawa Keichiro. The loan will facilitate the swift recovery of areas after natural disasters by promoting policy actions on disaster risk reduction and management and strengthening disaster preparedness. Japan is the Philippines' largest official development assistance provider of loan and grant commitments.
The Philippine government surpasses its tax collection target for July. The Bureau of Internal Revenue collected 273.1 billion pesos in taxes last month. The Tax Bureau initially set a collection target of 13 billion pesos. That amount is also higher compared to the 75 billion pesos collected for the same period last year. This brings the cumulative collection from January to July 2023 to 1.4 trillion pesos. Philippine shares swing to positive territory as the local stock market resumed trading after a public holiday. This report.
Philippine shares kicked off the shorter trading week in positive territory as traders returned from the long weekend. The PSE index climbed over 1% to close at 62.25. Edmund Lee, president of Calum Trading Institute, says bad and good data have already priced in by the markets and that most of the volatility is coming from the stronger dollar.
When the dollar starts to rally, then you see that shift in narrative. And basically that's exactly what we've seen over the course of the last 2 to 3 weeks, where we've seen a sell-off in the PSE in general. Now we're starting to see more resistance in the dollar, and now we're starting to look at oversold conditions.
Despite prices being relatively cheap, as Lee puts it, value turnover continued to be challenged at 5.4 billion pesos with very little foreign participation.
Investors having an alternative, for example, instead of buying the PSE, you can just buy in, for example, like Philippine Treasuries, get your 6.5% and pay off that volatility. People are still being risk averse. And as long as inflation remains sticky, which in our opinion might be the case, we think at interest rates, as long as they're going to be elevated, you'll probably see very minimal participation with regards to foreign.
He advises investors to position in more defensive stocks like power-related companies, which offer a decent yield. In corporate news, Double Dragon officially breaks ground for its Hotel 101 Niseko project in Japan, making it the first ever Filipino homegrown hotel chain to expand beyond the Philippines. Leading the Hokkaido event was Double Dragon chair Edgar Injapsia II and co-chair Tony Tan Kaktiong. The hotel, to be built at the 1.17-hectare property, will have 482 rooms and is seen to be completed by 2026. Meanwhile, Eastern Communications inks a partnership with the ICT subsidiary of telco giant PLDT. The company says the deal will establish a point of presence in ePLDT's data center that's soon to rise in Santa Rosa, Laguna. The partnership is also seen to bolster Eastern Communications' operational capacity in disaster recovery. And Sun Life gets regulatory approval overseas for the launch of its normal course issuer bid. The NCIB will seek to purchase close to 3% or 17 million common shares of the company's total 587 million. Sun Life adds this will enable it to return capital to shareholders as part of its overall capital management strategy. Taiwanese e-scooter brand Gogoro offering Filipinos a sustainable option to get around without hurting their wallets. Gogoro Philippines CEO Bernard Lamzon says their two-wheeled smart vehicles hope to address two pain points in the transport sector. Those are traffic congestion and soaring pump prices. He also shared the company is putting up more battery swapping stations across the metro for increased accessibility.
This is an entirely different technology. It is not a plug-in. It is a battery swap. and you can't charge the battery elsewhere. You need to go to a battery swapping station to get a fully charged battery. Competitive pricing will be there when it's compared to the internal combustion engine motorcycles, especially when you look at the total cost of ownership, which includes the acquisition cost of the vehicle, the maintenance, the gas. Overall, in total, it's actually less expensive to be able to maintain a two-wheel EV versus an ICE motorcycle.
Switching gears now, a Filipino nonprofit group from Utah organizes book drives to help Philippine schools establish their own libraries. Jared Bray tells us more.
They came bearing books, boxes of young adult fiction, and children's literature.
I mostly bought some Pete the Cat books.
For a book drive designed to support schools lacking libraries in the Philippines.
This project is great to be able to make a big difference in those children's lives, to help to love reading, love learning, love education.
Filipino community leaders organized this event for a new nonprofit called Bookworms for the Philippines.
The goal is to hopefully we can help schools in the Philippines to build libraries and give them books that they need.
Thanks to book drives and donations from schools in the Salt Lake City area, Bookworms for the Philippines now has these.
Wow.
And those.
Oh.
And more.
There's probably two 20-foot-footer containers of books, children's books.
Which will eventually make their way to 12 schools like this on Bohol Island, replacing worn-out books and helping educators establish library programs and services.
It's an ongoing mission. There's a lot of work to do.
That's why Rina says she's grateful for events like this and the support of the Filipino community.
My heart is just so full right now, like overwhelming joy.
Jared Bray, ABS-CBN News, Orem, Utah.
Sports, it's win or go home time for Gilas Pilipinas in the ongoing FIBA World Cup. The national team will go up against powerhouse Italy this evening, and many experts believe this will be the toughest match for Gilas in the group stage. Gilas needs to beat Italy by at least 13 points and hope the Dominican Republic will defeat Angola to advance to the next round. Game time, 8 p.m. at the Araneta Coliseum.
A Filipino-American swimming prodigy is hoping to bring home more medals from the World Aquatics Junior Championships in honor of the Philippines. Steve Evangelist tells us more.
Up. 17-year-old Filipino-American swimming prodigy Gian Santos is off to represent the Philippines. The Southern California teenager and Philippine record holder arrived in Israel this past weekend to compete in the World Aquatics Junior Swimming Championships. Santos, whose mother Didi hails from Bacolod and father Marlon from Pampanga, has been on an intense training regimen this past summer.
Training's been really difficult, my coach. We have 8 practices a week. Monday, Wednesday, Friday is 3 hours. Tuesday, Thursday, it's doubles, 2 hours in the morning, 1.5 in the afternoon. And then Saturday, I come back in the morning for another 2 hours of swimming. And it's been brutal. Like, the sets have been really difficult. And we're a really small, tight-knit group, about 10 to 12 people, really close. And then we always push each other to be our best in the water. The hard training's really been paying off.
Last year, Santos took home a silver and 3 bronze medals at the Southeast Asian Age Group Championship in Malaysia. He placed in the top 5 in 8 of his events. This past July, the dual citizen set Philippine junior national records in his age group in the 200 and 400 individual medleys.
It's really humbling to be representing my country, you know. Having all my training has been paying off, and then being able to get the Philippine record after all that hard work, it really makes it all worth it. And then now, next month, I'm going to Junior Worlds, representing my country on a big stage, and it's just really humbling to be representing the country.
Just a couple years ago, the lifelong swimmer wasn't even sure if he'd be taking his swimming career this far, as he had suffered a health scare.
When I had that episode, I was out of the water for about a week, and in that week, not being able to swim, I was thinking about how much the sport really meant to me, and if I lost it all, I would be a completely different person. Thankfully, it was nothing bad. It was just asthma related. Then I could just take an inhaler and I'll be okay. But that was a really scary time because swimming means so much to me. I'm basically like a fish. I live in the water almost.
The Junior World Championships begin on September 4th, and Santos will have 7 events over 5 days. While colleges have begun recruiting him, a successful run in Israel would set the stage for the World Championships in Doha in February, hoping that these big meets can lead him to either the 2024 or 2028 Olympics, one stroke at a time. Steve Angeles, CBS-CBN News, Irvine, California.
And before we go, catch a discussion about the eGov Super App on ANC's Business Outlook. Later at 8 p.m., we'll be speaking with Philippine Information and Communications Technology Secretary Ivan Uy.
Those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Insight.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.